Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Welcome to Online Worship with Ramona Avenue Christian Church. I'm Dr. Matt. Welcome you to this time of worship, wonder, and new life. Yeah. Actually, this is the first Sunday of Lent. So this past Wednesday was Ash Wednesday, a day where we remember our mortality. Remember that we are sinful, finite creatures before God. And now we are entering into this season, Lent. And during this season, we take about 40 days, echoing the 40 days that Jesus was tempted in the wilderness, which, strangely enough, is what I'm going to preach about a little later. And we take those 40 days and we remember and try to live into the depths of Christ's ministry and his especially his movement toward the cross, so that when we get to Passion Week, or Palm Sunday and Passion Week and Holy Week, and then into the celebration of Easter, we will be prepared to be fully immersed in part of that. And one thing that people often do for Lent, for the time of Lent, is that they give something up. And And so I've done various things over the years, interesting things. Several years back, I gave up meat for Lent, became vegetarian, and ended up carrying that on for another several months after after Easter, in fact. A year or two ago, I think it was, I used only feminine pronouns for God during Lent. Which, among other things, taught me that I don't use pronouns for God that often. So, but building on that, I've decided that this Lent, I am going to give up masculine pronouns for God for Lent. I've mostly given them up anyway. But what I'm going to use instead is they, them pronouns for God. And so you might hear me do that occasionally, although, like I said, I don't use pronouns for God a lot, but I really like the idea, this idea of using they, them pronouns for God. And as with a lot of things these days, I got the idea from TikTok. And I know that seems like a strange place to get your theological ideas, but hey, you know, there's all kinds of TikToks, all kinds of videos. But if you think about it, right, if God is beyond gender, which we believe God is, the Orthodox belief is God is not male or female, even though we use these masculine terms and Jesus even refers to God as Father, we don't think of God as having gender, of having sex in the way that, you know, the way we do. And go back to Genesis 1:27, and we are made in the image of God, and we are made male and female. And in the parallelism of the passage, those two lines are put in parallel so that the image of God is reflected in male and female. And it doesn't even say men and women or man and woman. It says male and female. So that it's like gender terms. And so the they, them as a pronouns for to use for a person has become a little more salient, has become more visible in the culture over the past few years, as people have come out as non-binary and wanting to use they, them pronouns. But the singular they goes back hundreds of years in English. And in fact, you probably use it sometimes without even realizing it. Like if we're talking about somebody, but it's kind of an unspecified person, or you're not exactly sure who you're talking about, you'll often use they or them, you know. Well, you know, you'll say, well, you know, I heard that the guest speaker this year is supposed to be fantastic. Oh, do you know who they are? No, I haven't heard much about them, but, you know, I've just heard that they're great. Perfectly normal English right there. And you're just using they, them because the gender of the person is not known to the speaker. Well, similarly, if the gender of God is not known in the sense that God doesn't have gender. God is beyond that, or maybe encompasses that, all of that, then why not use they, them? And it has this weird little side effect. Now, this might, this runs up against heresies a little bit. You got to be careful, I suppose. but if we think of God as a Trinity, right, it kind of also makes sense, right? They being the three persons of the Godhead. But yeah, you don't want to push that too far, because then we ended up in tritheism, which is where you have three gods. So three persons, one God is what we say. So that was quite an explanation, but so that's what I'm doing for Lent. Now, we are going to have a service here. Let's see. I guess I should tell you about that. We are going to take communion as usual. So something to eat, something to drink. We'll partake together later in the service. We have some special music today. And this one is in particular, it's an interesting intersection of things this week, because this is the first Sunday of Lent. It is also the last Sunday of Black History Month. And it is the, just a couple of days ago, we had the 1 year anniversary of the beginning of the war in Ukraine. So there are these kind of swirling things together. And so for special music today, we're going to use Wes's, his arrangement of Let There Be Peace on Earth. And let it begin with me. And let there be peace on earth, reflecting this, our hope and our prayer for the country of Ukraine, as it's been invaded by Russia now for over a year, by the time you see this. Let there be peace on earth as we move through Lent, but also let there be peace on earth as we think of the experience of Black folks in our country, and the experience that they've had, and how little peace there has been at points. So it kind of is playing kind of triple duty here. But so we'll have that in a little while. Let there be peace on earth. And aside from that, I'm going to talk about the sermon title, but I'll save that for the sermon. So I want to invite us to enter into this time of worship by singing together the Lord's Prayer. So, Church, as we come to our time of prayer today, I wanted to circle back to something that I did at the beginning of February, and got a little derailed by illness and so on. But this is the last Sunday of Black History Month, and my intention this month was to give you each week an example of the presence of African and people of African descent in the Bible. And so I started off with, you know, the sons of Joseph, if you remember that. And then the following week I was laid out with that nasty cold. And that kind of threw me off. And so, in a sense, to kind of make up for the missed weeks there, I have two for today. And these are both in the New Testament. First, we have Simon of Cyrene. And Cyrene was a city in North Africa, which is in what is now Libya. Okay, so in North Africa there, Simon of Cyrene. And you might recognize the name, but if you don't, he was the one who was compelled to carry Jesus' cross. So when he's, dragging the cross through the city, and he collapses a couple times, the Romans grab this guy from the crowd and make him carry Jesus' cross. And there's some debate about whether he may have already been a follower, like a disciple of Jesus, or not. But it's pretty clear that if he wasn't, he became one. Because his children are named, his sons, Rufus and Alexander. And his children were named probably for a couple different reasons. One, that if you didn't believe the story, at least for the early audience of this story, go ask his kids, right? Go ask Rufus and Alexander if this is what happened. And also, because they were known to the audience, it quite likely, and according to a passage at the end of Romans, they had become disciples or had become Christians. And so whether Simon had faith at the moment he carried the cross or not, we don't know, but he definitely became a follower of Jesus, and his children also were followers of Jesus. And so we have the presence of this African man who carried Jesus' cross, and then whose two sons become, and possibly his wife, according to Romans, become well-known people, at least, in the early church. So, and I've even heard it said, kind of slightly tongue-in-cheek, that, they had to get a black man to carry the cross because, that's what we do with people with black skin. Now, continuing on in the New Testament, the second person I want to talk about is, and we don't know this person's name, but we do know his position. He was an official in the government of Ethiopia. And he was a servant of the queen of Ethiopia, basically. And he had come, presumably, from what we can tell in the book of Acts, I think it's chapter 8, we can tell that he came to Jerusalem to worship, and he was returning home when Philip, the apostle, was spirited, taken by the Holy Spirit, to meet up with him. And he was not only Ethiopian and an official, but he was also a eunuch. And so he was a sexual minority, we could say, or someone who had been neutered, in a sense. So he would be, in today's language, he would be possibly intersex or non-binary. And so this black queer person, right, is talks with this apostle, Philip, and then there's water there, and he says, what's to prevent me from being baptized? And so, Philip can't think of anything, so he baptizes him. And so then this new Christian, this newly baptized African queer man, non-binary person, goes on back to Ethiopia, right? And in fact, there's a strong tradition of Christianity in Ethiopia, and it's hard to know historically how exactly Christianity came to Ethiopia, but the claims are that it goes way back, and that in fact that there were Jews. There's even a Jewish community in Ethiopia that would predate time of Christ. So there we have an Ethiopian, this is sub-Saharan Africa, coming to Jerusalem and being included and being brought into the family of God, and not just a black person, but a queer person as well. So there you go. You got your two for this Black History Month moment. Now, this is also an interesting moment. I mentioned at the beginning of the service that it is the one-year anniversary. Yay. We don't want to, it's not really an anniversary to celebrate, is it? But we just passed the one-year mark of the war in Ukraine, and the tensions are growing. The West has been supplying more and more things. There have been more sanctions coming in against Russia, and Russia recently also just pulled out of the New START treaty, which was a nuclear restraint treaty, basically, against proliferation of nuclear weapons. And so the fact that they pulled out of that is concerning. So those are things to be praying about, to be praying for Ukraine, to continue to pray for Ukraine, to be praying about this this new direction that Russia is taking under Putin with regard to nuclear weapons. I honestly don't see them using them. I think the blowback would be so great that it would be a really untenable thing for them to do. But but then there's Putin. Now on Monday, this past Monday, just after our service, or the day after our last service, Turkey, that southeastern part of Turkey and Syria, was hit with another earthquake, this time a 6.4, which was not, you know, it's that's strong, but I mean, it's nothing near the 7.7 that they had a few weeks ago, but still enough to, you know, knock down some weakened buildings. And I can't imagine the psychological toll that has on people, with the death toll now, I think, up over 47,000 people between Turkey and Syria. And then to have the earth shake again, even if it's not quite as bad, but still bad enough, it's hard to fathom the emotional toll and the psychological toll that takes on people. So we can continue to pray for Turkey and Syria, and not just pray with words, but let's pray with some dollars. Let's pray with some actual concrete steps that we can take to help with the recovery and the rebuilding of that area, really. A couple other things going on. Weather has been really out of the ordinary. it was actually pretty hot here not too long ago, it felt like, but it's not anymore. Here in Southern California, we're having quite a cold snap, in fact. Although, relatively speaking, it's still, you know, I was texting with my mom, and she's saying that they're having one of the warmest Februaries on record there in Ohio, and the temperatures are pretty similar to what they are here in Southern California. But for us, here in Southern California, it's cold, you know, to the point where this morning, back on Saturday morning, we actually had snow in Upland, at least. Now, I don't know, churches in Laverne, I'm not sure if it snowed over there, but I know there have been snow around the area. And so that happened, which, just to give you a sense of how rare that is, I have lived now in Southern California for over 20 years, and I can only think of one other time that I've actually seen snow in this area, like in the valleys, right? There's always snow in the mountains in the winter, but to have it come all the way down to where, you know, where we are here in the valleys, I think that this is the second time in 20 years, so, or over 20 years. So that's, you know, significant. And much of the country this past week was dealing with a real cold snap and blizzard conditions and so on. So we want to be praying for folks that they can get the heat, find warm places to be, that they can be safe, and that everyone can be safe on the roads, driving around and so on. And finally, I just want to mention that you probably heard just recently on the news that the Speaker of the House, Kevin McCarthy, it was revealed that he's he released, I think it was 40,000 or so hours of surveillance footage from January 6th to Tucker Carlson of Fox. I don't know what to call it, Fox News. It's I don't know, Knox Fox Propaganda Channel? I don't know. But that is a really troubling development on a few levels. One, that it would be released just to one news outlet, not others. But also that he would release so much of it because there's no way that's all been reviewed. And I was listening to a podcast earlier, and they were talking about how there might be information in some of that video about where they take Congress people when they are, you know, trying to get them to a safe location, where they take the Speaker of the House, where they take, you know, other folks, procedures and so on about the security of the building, like things like that could be revealed in all of this video. And so, just really pray that it won't go anywhere dangerous. And then also just wondering what in the world, you know, Tucker will do with it. Because I'm sure that we'll be seeing some of that. So those are some things. That's what I got. And, you know, people are continuing to be sick, so we're going to be praying for that. I was reading recently, it's not that the colds are necessarily worse in terms of the intensity and all this year. The evidence seems to be that it's not actually more prevalent than a normal cold and flu season. And the COVID rates we know are really low, but that after a good 2-3 years of almost no colds because of masking and isolation and so on, that it's kind of roaring back with a vengeance, and some of our immunity from common colds may have waned a bit during those years, and also we just kind of forgotten how much it sucks to have a cold, because it does. So, yeah, and I say that as our own, our freshly adulted Anna, who just turned 18 about a week ago, has come down with something kind of nasty, and she seemed to be kind of miserable, so I want to mind prayers for her. So, and it's Lent, so just keep that in mind as well as we go to God in prayer. Let us pray. God, we thank you for this season in which we set aside this time to remember and to live into our mortality and what that means to us. The fact that we are limited, that we only have so many years in this world, and that we are sinners. And so, Almighty God, we pray that through this season of Lent, by prayer and study and self-giving, we may penetrate more deeply into the mystery of Christ's sufferings, that following the way of his cross and passion, we may come to share in the glory and triumph of his resurrection. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Good morning. The scripture selection today is from Matthew 4, verses 1 through 11. Then the Spirit led Jesus up into the wilderness so that the devil might tempt him. After Jesus had fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, he was starving. The tempter came to him and said, "Since you are God's son, command these stones to become bread." Jesus replied, "It's written, people won't live only by bread, but by every word spoken by God." After that, the devil brought him into the holy city and stood him at the highest point of the temple. He said to him, "Since you are God's son, throw yourself down. For it is written, I will command my angels concerning you, and they will take you up in their hands so that you won't hit your foot on a stone." Jesus replied, "Again, it's written, don't test the Lord your God." Then the devil brought him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. He said, "I'll give you all these if you bow down and worship me." Jesus responded, "Go away, Satan, because it's written, you will worship the Lord your God and serve only him." The devil left him, and angels came and took care of him.
So, church, we have entered the season of Lent, and part of what that means is living into the hard stuff of Jesus' life, of Jesus' ministry, and the first place we go is the temptation. So Jesus is baptized by his cousin John the Baptist, and then is driven almost immediately, from the way it's told, into the desert, into the wilderness, right? And so this was an area of just devastation. I mean, or not devastation, but desert, right? Just imagine, like, you know, very tan, dirt, sand, whatever, not a whole lot of plants, not much water, not much of anything. And so it says the Spirit led him. So the Spirit of God leads Jesus out into the desert, into the wilderness, so that the devil might tempt him. So the Spirit of God leads Jesus into the wilderness for the express purpose of letting the devil tempt him. Okay. So, and this is something interesting about the way the devil is portrayed in the Bible, and I want to point this out because I think it's important. Here it says the Spirit leads Jesus out so the devil might tempt him, right? That makes it sound like God is allowing the devil to tempt Jesus, that maybe the devil wouldn't be able to otherwise. Well, that actually fits pretty well with the portrayal of Hasatan, the Satan, the accuser, that we see back in the book of Job. If you read the first couple chapters of the book of Job, the first two chapters, the accuser, Satan, Hasatan, the Satan, the Satan, comes before God and in essence has to receive permission to afflict Job with all the things that he does, and then has to come back and get permission again to harm his body, but is not given permission to kill him. So again, there in Job, it seems that the devil or Satan, again, is constrained in what they're able to do by God. And so here, it appears, and it would be consistent with Job again, that God is taking, Jesus is going into the desert to allow the devil to tempt him. And it says that he goes out there and he fasts for 40 days and 40 nights. And then it says he was starving, right? Which, of course, yes, he would be. That's, you know, almost 6 weeks. Could you imagine? Almost 6 weeks with no food. Presumably he drank because you would die after that much time with no water. But he hasn't eaten anything in all that time, and he's starving. And only after those 40 days of fasting does the devil show up, does the tempter show up. And the first temptation is to make food. Yeah, that makes sense. Makes a lot of sense, right? Jesus is starving, so you come and you tempt him with the one thing that he is really starting to miss. And probably started to miss a long time ago, actually, because I just can't even imagine. I think the longest fast I've done is maybe like 30 hours, you know, a little over a day. And and that's rough. I did do a complete fast once, did a 24-hour, no eating or drinking, and it isn't as bad, actually. In some ways, for some reason, I didn't feel as hungry, but I definitely got a headache, and the dehydration is rough. I can't even imagine after 40 days of not eating, and the tempter comes to him and says, you are God's son. Right? So there's an interesting thing, right? Right off, he says, since you're God's son, so the devil is admitting you are God's son. I know this. He's not denying it at all. And we'll see something else interesting along those lines in a moment. He says, you're God's son, command the stones to become bread, because you could do that. And of course, Jesus says, well, you know, people don't live by bread only, but by every word spoken by God. And this is from, this comes from the scriptures, from Deuteronomy chapter 8. And so Jesus quotes this scripture back to him and to the tempter. And basically is like, no, I have more sustenance than just food. Okay. Too bad, try again. So the devil does, of course. Brings him into the holy city. And this is where something interesting happens here, because he takes Jesus into the holy city, into Jerusalem, takes him up on the top of the temple, right, which is quite tall, and says, throw yourself down. Because it's written in the scriptures, and then the devil quotes to him from Psalm 91, right, Psalm of Protection. Psalm 91, verse 11 and 12, and the devil quotes it and says, I will command my angels concerning you, and they will take you up in their hands so that you won't hit your foot on a stone. So not only is Satan, the devil, acknowledging that Jesus is the Son of God, he's also quoting scripture. See, the devil is extra tricky. It's the ones that sound right. They say some things that sound right. They can even quote scripture and acknowledge Jesus as God's son and still be the devil. Keep that in mind, right? When you're discerning, what kind of teachers to listen to, when you're discerning what sorts of ministries to support or follow, remember that the devil can quote scripture and the devil can acknowledge God's son, right? And what does Jesus say? He says, you'll know them by their fruits. So what we look for is, what are the fruits of the ministry, right? Is it that they're enriching the pastor? Is it that they're serving the poor? What is it that's happening as a result of the ministry? That's how you evaluate. So Jesus, of course, has a response to that. And again, he goes to the scriptures, again to the book of Deuteronomy, and he says, it's also written, don't test the Lord your God. All right, fair enough. Now this is where the third temptation is where the title of the sermon comes in. It says, then the devil brought him to a very high mountain. We don't know what mountain it was, but some really high mountain. Showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. So this must be a super tall mountain, right? Or just kind of takes him up into space, and he's looking down like a satellite, right? All the kingdoms of the world, and basically says, I will give you all of them if you bow down and worship me. Now this is where the sermon title comes in. You can live at the mall. You can live at the mall. Why would that be my sermon title, right? What does that have anything to do with it? Well, you can live at the mall. That's a line from the song All Right by Kendrick Lamar. Now, if you're not familiar with Kendrick Lamar, you should be. But if you're not, he's a hip-hop artist, a rapper, and is probably the most famous rapper on the planet right now. He's won multiple Grammys. He even won a Pulitzer Prize, which I didn't even know they had one for music, but he won it. He's sold millions upon millions of albums. And not for no reason. The guy is brilliant. His lyrics are chef's kiss, right? His lyrics do things with images and connections and so on that you just wouldn't believe. There's some stuff in there. So in the song All Right, which, by the way, is the it's kind of an unofficial anthem of the Black Lives Matter movement. All right, this song, it became that in the earlier years of that. This song talks about all the temptations that Kendrick felt himself up against and feels himself up against. And a lot of it is, and it isn't the only place in the album. This is from the album To Pimp a Butterfly, and it in several points in there, in some of his other albums even, he talks about this. It's kind of this continuing theme of his temptation to forget where he came from, to turn his back on his community, to buy into the rich lifestyle, the rapper lifestyle, with all the fancy cars and the chains and everything. And he, so in the song, and I'll write the second verse, he says, what you want? You a house? You a car? 40 acres and a mule? A piano? A guitar? Anything. See, my name is Lucy. I'm your dog. You can live at the mall. Okay, so this is the moment of temptation, right? This is Jesus on the top of the mountain. I mean, I'm not saying Kendrick Lamar is Jesus, obviously, but this is the moment, right? Lucy, when he says Lucy in there, that's short for Lucifer, and he makes that's pretty clear from other parts of other things that in the album. Lucy is Lucifer, and so it's Lucifer saying to Kendrick, "What do you want? You want a house, a car, 40 acres and a mule?" And that is a reference to the promises after the Civil War for the newly freed, formerly enslaved people, that there was this promise made by some government officials that every formerly enslaved person was going to receive 40 acres and a mule so that they could kind of get going. And a few people did, but no, most of them didn't. The government didn't follow through on that promise. And so it's become kind of a symbol. The idea of 40 acres and a mule has become a symbol of the broken promises of Reconstruction after the Civil War. And it's even referenced in the Gone with the Wind, which I haven't actually seen all the way through, but I know it's referenced in there. So what Satan is saying is, or Lucifer, Lucy, you want a house, you want a guitar, you want your 40 acres and a mule that was promised way back, you want a piano, a guitar, anything. See, my name is Lucy. I'm your dog, which is like, I'm your dude, right? I'm with you. You can live at the mall, right? And the you can live at the mall is like this image of like, you could have it all, right? Is there something you want? Well, just take it. You can have anything, right? He says, anything. My name is Lucy, right? This is exactly the temptation that Jesus faces on the mountain of, on whatever mountain this is, right? The mountain of temptation. And Jesus' response, okay, is right now there's the worship piece, right? It's like you need to worship me. So what Jesus' response is, go away, Satan, because it's written you will worship the Lord your God and serve only him. Serve only them, right? You will worship the Lord your God and serve only them, okay? And then the devil leaves and the angels come and take care of him. Kendrick doesn't go that direction, because Lucy in the song doesn't say anything specifically about worship, but you can see the struggle in the following lines. He says, I can see the evil. I can tell I know when it's illegal. I don't think about it. I deposit every other zero. Thinking of my partner, put the candy, painted on the Regal, digging in my pocket, ain't a profit big enough to feed you. Every day my logic, get another dollar just to keep you in the presence of your chica. Yeah. And so on. He goes on. I am not a rapper, so I'm not going to even try. But for example, I can see the evil. I can tell when it's illegal, right? I don't think about it. Deposit every other zero. Dig into my pocket, ain't a profit big enough to feed you, right? There ain't a profit enough to feed you because the desires, the greed, it will just eat up and eat up. And then a little ways down, he says, I don't talk about it, be about it. Every day I see cool. If I got it, then you know you got it. Heaven, I can reach you, right? So there's a shift now, a shift away from the temptation. And he goes on, and then he says, I rap, I black on track, so rest assured, my rights, my wrongs, I write till I'm right with God. Yeah. He'll write till he's right with God. Fantastic stuff, really. So you see in there, right, what he's doing, in a sense, is he's doing a riff on this story and putting it in his context, the context of a guy from Compton who has come out of some really rough life experience and is being drawn toward having it all, right? Being rich, being famous. I mean, he is famous, and he's not going to get around that because he's amazing. But there's this temptation, right, to go back, to just suck into lifestyle. But he doesn't. For example, in that same album, song I, at the beginning of the song, he's introduced, and it's that he's actually, it's recorded live, and he's actually gone back to Compton to, and they're like, the number one rapper in the world is, and he's like, he's come back home, right? He's like, he doesn't lose touch with where he's come from. Likewise here, Jesus doesn't lose touch with who he is. He is not going to worship the devil. Good Lord, no. Worship the Lord your God and serve only them. So that's what he does. And when he stands fast like that, Lucy is out of there. And so we pray that Lucy would stay away from Kendrick. We pray that the devil, Hasatan, the tempter, would stay away from us, right? In this time of Lent, this is a good opportunity for us to be thinking about the things in our lives that tempt us, the things that want to draw us away from God, away from the people around us, to draw us into, whatever, whether it's greed, whether it's power, whether it's just ignoring the need that we see around us. Whatever that is, right? Getting caught up in the accolades that people, give us. So I pray for all of us that during this time of Lent, we will be able to resist temptation so that we can live into what Jesus is doing in this world. Not just what he did a couple thousand years ago, but what he's doing now. So let's pray. God, we thank you for this scripture and for the spin that we've seen on it through Kendrick Lamar's music. Pray that you would open our eyes to ways that we have been tempted away from you, the ways that we are pulled in different directions, and help us to resist those pulls. God, help us to have the strength to meet the moment when we are tempted, so that we can come through, and that the devil would leave and that your angels would come and minister to us. And so we pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Now, as we prepare ourselves to come to Christ's table, I invite us to sing together. We're going to sing the song 40 Days and 40 Nights, and this is about temptation in the wilderness. So let's sing. Welcome to Christ's table. In this Lenten season, we seek for Christ. We look for Christ. We await Christ. And we follow the road that's going to lead to this table and to the cross and to the glorious hope beyond. On that night when Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he gave thanks. Baruch eta Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, hamotzi lechem min haaretz. Blessed are you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth. And he gave it to his disciples and he said, take, eat. This is my body, broken for you. Do this to remember me. And then he took a cup and again he gave thanks. Baruch eta Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, pere pri hagafen. Blessed are you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who brings forth. Baruch eta Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, pere pri hagafen. Blessed are you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe, the creator of the fruit of the vine. And he said to them, drink, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant poured out for many for forgiveness of sins. And I tell you the truth, I won't drink again of the fruit of the vine until I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. The body of Christ, broken for us. the blood of Christ shed for us. Thanks be to God for the gifts of God, for the people of God. Hail the power of Jesus' name. That's our hymn of invitation for today. And so as we sing, I invite us to commit ourselves and recommit ourselves to the God who loves us and who leads us through this season and offers us true gifts in this world. So let's sing. Now, as we go through this Lenten season, may God be above us to watch over us. May God be beneath us to lift us up. May God be ahead of us to lead us. May God be behind us to push us. May God be beside us to walk with us. And may God be within us to love us forever. Amen.